Hello viewers, today we are going to take up the continuing portion of the audit procedure. We shall be discussing the vouching and verification part, that is the unit 3rd. We shall be discussing various aspects of vouching. To continue with, we shall be doing the cash, vouching and verification. The aspect which need to be emphasized over here is the casting and totaling. The casting and totaling means when the totals have to be made of the cash ledger, they have to be totaled properly, and this aspect should be checked by the auditor. He should also see that all the totals and all the amounts have been entered in ink. That is, they have been penned down properly in permanent ink and they are not available in the pencil format, because there is a risk of the accountant changing all the totals and the postings. There are some common ways in which the fraud can be committed. Now, these aspects can occur either in inflating the cash or deflating the cash. Some of these aspects which need to be considered are: number one is the undercasting the receipts side of the cash book. With this, the cash will become less. Overcasting of the payment side of the cash, again, more cash outgo will be shown, hence lesser cash. The third one is the fictitious entry showing cash being deposited, posting an amount of cash sale to the credit of a party and subsequently withdrawing the amount. Also, another way to commit a fraud is wrong totals or balances being carried forward in the cash book or in the ledger. The auditor has to particularly give a lot of attention that these basic entries are checked, vouched and done on his behalf by the staff, usually comprising of the article and audit clerks, who shall be checking each aspect of the cash totaling and casting part. Now is the preparation of the bank reconciliation statement. The onus or the responsibility to prepare the bank reconciliation statement is on the client or the assessee. The auditor shall not prepare the bank reconciliation statement. On the other hand, the accountant of the client or assessee shall be preparing a bank reconciliation statement and handing it over to the auditor. The auditor has to get the copy of the bank reconciliation statement from him, sign it and keep it in his records. Also, subsequently, he has to verify it with the bank passbook of the client or the assessee. The next area of concern is the audit of payments. Under the Indian Stamp Act 1899, the instruments whereby payment is acknowledged should bear a revenue stamp. The following should be checked: the receipts produced in evidence of payments shown to have been made are properly stamped. The date of issue of stamp paper from the stamp office is entered on its back. The design of the revenue stamp is also changed from time to time. The various kinds of payments we shall be taking up in this study today are purchase of goods, transaction with directors, remuneration paid to the directors, payment for acquisition of assets, payment controlled by Companies Act 1956, that is section 227(1)(a), assets acquired on the hire purchase basis, assets acquired on lease, payment of the expenses, payment of taxes, customs and excise duties in case it is a manufacturing concern, travelling expenses of the employees and the directors, repairs to the assets, preliminary expenses, salaries and wages, petty cash, advertisement expenses, payment of dividends and the retirement gratuity to the employees. One by one, we shall be taking up each item of payment and look into the vouching part of the payment. The first and foremost is the purchase of the goods. the purchase of goods can be verified with the aid of the cash memos or receipted invoices by the suppliers. The credit purchases shall be vouched with the receipts issued by suppliers and credit to their accounts on the basis of invoices entered in the day book. Now, when these credit purchases are received into the entity, they shall be entered in the goods inward received book or in the stock ledger. So, a cross tallying shall be done by the auditor from this book also. Now, some of the transactions with director which need emphasis and which need a vouching to be done by the auditor. The director of a company or his relative, a firm in which a director or his relative is a partner, or a private company of which the director is a member, cannot enter into any contract with a company for the sale or purchase or supply of goods and materials, or for underwriting subscriptions to shares or debentures with the consent of the board. So, all the directors who are entering into such transactions of sale, purchase, supply of goods and materials, underwriting contracts or subscriptions to shares or debentures, all these shall need a sanction of the board. Such a sanction has to be received 3 months within such a transaction has been entered into or prior to entering of the transaction. In the case if a company is having a paid up capital of 1 crore or more, in addition to the board's consent, prior approval of the central government would also be necessary. Every director of company interested or concerned, directly or indirectly, must disclose his interest to the company at the board meeting under section 299. He is also restrained from participating in voting at the resolution in which such a contract shall be adopted in that meeting. Now, the next payment which is made to the director by way of remuneration also requires vouching on behalf of the auditor. The first foremost thing which needs to be checked by the auditor is examination of the entitlement, whether the director is entitled to such a remuneration or not. Now, this power will already be given in the articles of association of the company in case it is a company, and if it is a limited liability partnership, then in the suitable document giving its charter or resolution. The next aspect to be covered is examination of adherence to the legal provisions, first being payment of managerial remuneration, second payment of the sitting fees, third overall limit to managerial remuneration, schedule 13 to the act that has laid down limits for payment of remuneration in case of no or inadequate profits, section 310 which provides for increase in the remuneration. So, all these aspects, again, they have been given in the articles, whether the directors are entitled to any managerial remuneration, to what extent they shall be paid the managerial remuneration or the sitting fees, whether there is an overall limit which is applicable to the directors, or the payment of the remuneration in case there is inadequacy or less profit or loss, and section 310 which provides for increase in the remuneration. The next area requiring the concentration by the auditor regarding vouching part is the payment for the acquisition of the assets. Assets one purchased belong to the SSE, the client, the company or the corporation. So, all these assets which have come into the business need to be entered into the balance sheet. Also, the title deeds etc. should be held in the company's or the client's name. The various other aspects which need consideration are, the purchase of the asset must be duly supported by the amount which has been paid. In case of an immovable property, title deeds should be inspected, property to be registered in client's name as per the requirement of Transfer of Property Act 1882. In case of movable property requiring registration of the ownership, example a car or ship, registration to be made in favor of the purchaser. In case of manufactured asset, all direct costs and expenses must be charged as cost of the asset on proper allocation of the total expenditure. Hence, the auditor has to see that the assets have been paid, they have the payment receipts are there in the company's name. Also, the registration has been done in the name of the client. It completes all the verification aspect relating to the Transfer of Property Act. If it is the case of manufactured asset, then all the expenses that have been incurred to bring the asset into its present form, all those expenses should be charged as a cost of the asset on proper allocation of the total expenditure. Now, there are few expenditures or payments which are controlled by the Companies Act 1956. There is a reporting requirement under Section 227(1)(a) if personal charges are debited to the revenue account. Only expenditures which are of business nature held incurred for the entity should be debited to the P&L account. No personal expenditure which have been incurred either for the directors or their employees should be entered in the P&L account. The second one is that the board of directors under Section 293 shall not, except with the consent of such company or subsidiary in general meeting, sell, lease or otherwise dispose of the whole or substantially the whole of the undertaking of the company, or where the company owns more than one undertaking of the whole or substantially the whole of any such undertaking. The reason and logic behind this is that it is going to affect the going concern concept of the entity. Hence, all these transactions cannot occur, and there is a reporting requirement under Section 227(1)(a). The next one is remitting or giving time for the repayment of or any debt due by the directors, except in case of renewal or continuance of an advance made by a banking company to its director in the ordinary course of business. So, a banking company can give time for the repayment of an advance or debt due by the director, but another company which is not a banking company cannot remit or give time to the directors for the repayment of the debts. The next one is the investment other than in trust security. It should be seen that if such an investment has done at all, it should not be otherwise than in the trust securities. Borrowing monies, where the amount borrowed together with the monies already borrowed by the company, apart from the temporary loans obtained from company's bankers in the ordinary course of business, exceeds the aggregate of paid up capital of the company and its free reserve. So, there has been a ceiling which has been put on the companies up to which amount it can actually borrow the monies from the outside authorities. Contributing amounts to charitable and other funds not related to the business of the company or the welfare of employees, the aggregate value of whereof exceeds in a financial year of rupees 50,000 or 5% of the average net profit during the three financial years immediately preceding, whichever is greater. Hence, again, there is a ceiling up to which the charity amount can be given away by the company for charitable purposes other than charitable purposes which are being done for the welfare of the employees, and this aggregate amount shall not exceed 50,000 or 5% of the average net profit of the company. A government company or any other company in existence for less than 3 years also cannot contribute to any political party or for any political purpose. In other cases, it should not exceed 5% of average net profit. Hence, a newly established company if 3 years have not elapsed of its formation, it cannot contribute to any political party for any political purpose. This will also include advertisement in the political magazine or promotion of its own company or contribution to any of the political funds. The next area of concern which requires vouching aspect of payments by the auditor is the assets which have been acquired on hire purchase basis. Hire purchase terms should be examined through the approval in the board's minute book. Hire purchase agreement should be examined carefully to note the description and cost of the machinery, hire purchase charges, terms of payment and rate of purchases. Hire purchase assets should be shown in the balance sheet with appropriate narration to indicate that it is not owned by the enterprise. The interest paid along with the installment should be debited to the interest account and not to the asset account. Assets acquired under hire purchase agreement should be recorded at full cash value with corresponding liability of the same amount, and the same amount should be calculated presuming an appropriate rate of interest. It should be recalled over here that in a hire purchase agreement, assets ownership does not pass on to the client or to the person who has bought the asset on HP system until he has paid the last installment. So until the last installment has been paid, the whole of the amount of the hire purchase agreement shall be shown by way of asset. Hence, the asset shall be recognized on the balance sheet, and an equal liability for the remaining amount of installments shall be shown in the balance sheet on the liability side. Also, the amount of interest on the hire purchase agreement system shall be shown in the P&L account by way of interest expenditure. Also, a proper disclosure regarding the hire purchase asset has to be made in the balance sheet with notes to the accounts. Now, let us do another aspect of the payment. The payment being made for the assets which have been acquired on the lease. First foremost will be the examination of the terms and conditions of the lease deed. If the part of the leasehold property has been sublet, examine the tenant's agreement. Then verify the relevant documents to check the cost of the property. In case it is an operating lease, then the following shall be done. Firstly, the lease payment should be recognized as an expense in profit and loss account on straight line basis over the lease term. Operating lease are those leases which have been done for the wasting assets like mines, quarries, etc. Hence, they do not have any useful life after the mining has been done. So, a full depreciation by writing it off over the straight line method system is recommended. In case it is a financial lease in which the ownership passes on to the person who has bought the asset on lease, the utility shall be maintained and there shall be some residual amount of the asset which shall be remaining. So, in case of the finance lease, the following treatment shall be done. Ensure that the risk and rewards pertaining to the ownership of the assets are transferred as per the accounting standard 19. The lessee should recognize the lease as an asset and as a liability at an amount equal to the fair value of the leased asset at the inception of the lease. Ensure contingent rents are recognized as an expense in profit and loss statement. Ensure the assets acquired under the finance lease are segregated from the owned assets. Now, the vouching aspect related to the payment of expenses. Normally, expenditure has to be written off in the year in which it is incurred. So, all the expenses which pertain to a particular financial year should be written off fully by debiting it to the P&L account. those expenditures which are of continuing nature, which are going to give a benefit for many years to accrue, they shall not be written off fully in that year, but they shall be deferred further. So we have to see whether it is revenue expenditure or it is a capital expenditure or a deferred revenue expenditure. So, however, expenses which relate to tangible and intangible assets can be capitalized if the recognition criteria are met as per the requirements of Accounting Standard 10 and Accounting Standard 26. In case the provision for outstanding expenses made in past year falls short and amount is material, disclosure should be made in the accounts in the year in which such amounts is charged. Now, this can be done by showing the amount separately in the inner column and explaining its nature, or by including it in appropriation section of profit and loss account. Auditor should make sure that no personal expenditure is charged to the business. In case of company, if personal expenditures are charged, it should be reported, particularly those which are not covered by contractual obligation or commercial practices. This is also one of the requirement under section 227(1)(a), which we had recently done in our discussion. It should also be verified that all expenses incurred, paid or payable have been included in the accounts, and if an expense relates to period beyond the year, an appropriate provision for the prepaid expenses should be done. This happens when expenditures have been done much before than what has been accrued in that year. So, appropriate provision regarding prepaid expenses should be made. Now, when some expenses are found to be adjusted in lump sum, especially at the close of the year, these should receive special attention of the auditor, as these might be fictitious items introduced to reduce the profit. Now, the vouching aspect related to the payment of taxes. Payment of income tax and other taxes consequent upon a regular assessment should be verified by copy of assessment order, assessment form, notice of demand and receipted challan. So, there is a considerably lot of external evidences which are available to check the vouching aspect of the payment of taxes. Hence, not much of fraud can be done relating to the taxes. Second one is payments or advance payment of income tax should be verified with notice of demand and receipted challan. Interest allowed on advance payment of income tax should be included as income, and penal interest charged for non-payment should be charged to the interest account. The audit procedure for custom duty shall be as follows. Custom duty is paid whenever there is an import and an export being done by the client or the assessee. This is with regard to items which are coming inside India or they are going outside India. Hence, there has to be an examination of custom duty in the cash book with reference to the bill of entry. Check the account of custom duty which was calculated correctly in accordance with the applicable rate. If the duty is paid by dealing or forwarding agent, examine the bill of entry with the agent's bill. If duty has been paid by the client directly, examine the bill of entry with receipt evidencing payment of custom duty. In case of disputed cases, a provisional payment may have been made, and the auditor should determine the duty payable and ensure that the balance amount is adjusted accordingly. The auditor should also verify the claim for duty drawback with reference to the acknowledge issued by the Directorate of Duty Drawback. Duty drawback is like a rebate in case of the custom duty which has been charged on the goods. It is a like of relief rebate, and the custom duty which has been paid by the client or assessee is paid back to him from the government. with this, we are concluding our today's session. In our session today, we discuss various aspects relating to the casting and totaling. We also discuss the bank reconciliation statement and then the vouching of the payments part. I hope you enjoyed the session. Thank you so much.